Curious about the many advantages of anodized aluminium parts and how we do it? Here's what you need to know in about 10 minutes. Hello, this is Gordon Stiles, founder and CEO of Star Rapid. I've been involved in rapid prototyping and new product development for more than 300 years, and I'm happy to welcome you to another episode of Serious Engineering for Serious Engineers.
Serious Engineering.
Here at Star, we just love making these videos. Personally, I have always seen myself as an educator, a teacher, if you will. So for me, the Serious Engineering series has always been about passing on all this wonderful engineering knowledge to the next generation. If you're as passionate about engineering as I am, which I know you are, because that's why you're here, then please, please, please share these videos with any lecturers, teachers, or trainers that you might know. And let's get the engineering love out to these students and apprentices who could benefit from the knowledge. Thank you. And now for something completely different. Do you know how Tom Cruise, Brad Pitt, and myself managed to stay so youthful and rust-free after three centuries? Well, they drink blood.
Why do you do this?
I like to do it.
Lots of blood, and as a result, they are pacified. But I found a better way of staying youthful for longer. I went with anodizing instead. Beats sucking blood, I can tell you. Well, maybe. Jokes aside, anodizing is a form of surface passivation. That means we use electrolysis to increase the natural tendency that aluminium already has to form a film of stable aluminium oxide on its surface. This pacifies the outer electrons so that they don't want to react with anything else. Why anodizing? Because it's cool, man, and because aluminium oxide is rated at 9 on the Mohs scale. The Mohs scale refers to naturally occurring minerals, with only diamond being harder at 10, which means that anodized aluminium has a very hard shell that resists scratching. That shell is also known as a barrier layer or anodic film. Here are some major benefits if you're considering using anodizing on your project. Reduced white rust. You've all seen it. Looks like spots of white mold on aluminium. Improved lubricity, cosmetic enhancement, corrosion resistance, easy to clean, environmentally benign and non-toxic, and it makes an ideal base for painting or powder coating. All of this together significantly reduces the maintenance cost of your product, but also increases longevity. Aluminium alloys. Aluminium alloys have different properties and all of them can be anodized, but not all of them give great results. The 2000 and 7000 series can be difficult to get consistent results with. We normally recommend aluminium alloys in the series 1000, 3000, 5000, and 6000 if possible. As always, it's great to consult your manufacturer before you begin your project. There are some other limitations that developers need to be aware of, so please pay heed to the following insights gleaned from our many years of anodizing tens of thousands of aluminium parts. The anodizing process. Now let's take a deep dive into the anodizing process. First, the part is thoroughly cleaned, rinsed, and surface etched. This requires several baths in a variety of detergents, acids, alkalis, desmutting agents, something my wife recommends for me every morning, and pure water. Then it's placed into an electrolytic solution, which is usually chromic acid for type 1 anodizing and sulfuric or oxalic acid for types 2 and 3. More on that in a moment. The target piece is connected to the positive side of the circuit, making it the anode, while the negative side is attached to a sacrificial donor plate or cathode. Once DC current is applied, no, not that DC. Once DC current is applied, positive and negative ions dissolve in the solution and are immediately attracted to the opposite poles to form the barrier layer. What is the barrier layer? The electric charge causes pores to form on and below the surface of the aluminium as excess ions escape. Interestingly, these pores make a geometrically regular pattern and form deeper columns as more current is applied. The aluminium thus exposed combines with the free oxygen radicals in solution to form aluminium oxide. This is the barrier layer, a defense against further chemical reactions in those areas. Type 1 coatings have the thinnest layers at less than 2.5 microns. Type 2 anodizing can be up to 25 microns thick, but we strongly recommend 17 microns. Remember that, 17 microns as the optimum depth. while type 3 hard anodizing goes up to 100 microns. Type 2 is the most common and what you normally find on household appliances, sporting goods or architectural fittings. And the nice stable pores etched into the surface are ideal for introducing tints or pigments. Hard anodizing. Hard anodizing, or type 3, offers the most corrosion resistance, UV protection, and resistance to wear in extreme environments. One common misconception is that type 3 is somehow harder than type 2, but it's not really. The only real difference is the depth of the anodizing and the acid and temperatures required to achieve that greater depth. Adding color. Color is added in two ways. For electrolytic coloring, the target piece is placed into another tank along with metal salts of tin, cobalt, or nickel. AC current drives this reaction, creating a very strong bond between the colored salts and the base metal. These colors tend to be earth tone, from a light champagne to bronze to solid black. The exact shade is determined by the depth of the pores and hence the amount of buildup of the metal salts over time. Parts can also be dip colored in a tank filled with organic or inorganic dyes. This method is fast and easy, and there are many more colors to choose from, but it isn't as durable. Herein lies one of the major drawbacks of anodizing. It's almost impossible to get an exact color match between parts. That's because the final color is a function of time in the dyeing tank, the temperature and the strength of the solution, and air agitation. The depth of the anodized barrier layer affects the color as well, and that depth is affected by current density, imperfections in the metal alloy, the variation of thickness of the part, the orientation in the anodizing tank, the surface preparation, and many other factors that are just too complicated to control precisely. Sealing the barrier layer. Finally, we want to seal the anodized surface, and that can be done by several different techniques. One is by dipping an uncolored part into deionized distilled water at close to 100 degrees centigrade. The time in the bath is about 2 minutes per micron, so if your layer is around 17 microns deep, you're looking at about 34 minutes. It creates a crystalline hydrate phase known as burmite. Given that the first time I saw that word, I thought it said bohemian, I think that deserves this. Scaramouche, will you do the fandango? Nice. Now, the subject of sealing anodized surfaces is so darn complicated. No, it really is. There's a link to a technical paper in the description below. Pro tip. If you are getting dye on your hands from anodized parts, it's probably because they didn't seal the parts. Other metals. Anodizing also works with magnesium, titanium, stainless steel, and other metals. The method of application and the chemical solutions differ depending upon the target material, though. In the case of titanium, colored effects are achieved not by adding dye, but by altering the electrical energy applied to the part over time. And if you haven't seen anodized parts in titanium, you have got to see this. They are amazing. Part holding. Anodizing requires that a part be immersed in a series of chemical baths. Holding the part, therefore, requires that it be mounted on a hanger, wire, or rack to keep it from falling to the bottom of the tank. Wherever the holding fixture touches the part, that area will be blocked and the anodizing chemicals won't work properly. That's why it's smart to design a place on your part that can be used for holding but won't be adversely affected cosmetically. Post-machining. There are a couple of concerns that developers need to consider. One is that the physical dimensions of the parts may be altered slightly, and this can be very hard to control or predict in advance. As a rough guide, your part will grow by half the thickness of the layer for each side. So a layer depth of 17 microns will make the overall part grow by 17 microns. For most applications, this isn't a big deal, and the part will work just fine. But if your tolerances are critical, then it means post-machining, in which case those areas will have to have anodized portions removed. For a similar reason, it's usually a good idea to plug up threaded holes to prevent them from having an oxide layer buildup. Deep pockets or recesses cannot be anodized reliably unless you drop a special cathode down the inside of the feature. Finally, because electricity is used to drive the reaction, the aluminium parts can behave like electrical sinks. That is, larger and more massive sections of a part will naturally draw more electrical current, while thinner areas will draw less. This in turn affects how quickly the oxide layer builds up in those areas, with thinner sections showing consequently less coverage over time and possibly looking shiny in comparison to thicker areas. That's another great reason to work closely with your suppliers so that your designs are optimized for the best anodizing results. We know that this is a complicated subject, but we hope you've learned some useful information that you can apply to your next project. Thanks again for joining us, and be sure to like, subscribe, and ding the bell. Now, excuse me whilst I immerse myself into a revitalizing bath of ionized metallic salts.